Let's get right to the point, shall we? Is JavaScript's garbage collector as bad as some people think it is? I have no idea, so let's poke at this a bit and see if we can learn something. Basically, when you allocate memory, in languages like C++, you have to explicitly free it, otherwise you have a memory leak. In languages like JavaScript, C#, Java, Go, these are all garbage collected languages. They handle a good chunk of the memory management for you. When you allocate some memory, at some point JavaScript has to decide when you're done with it. So if I allocate an array, here's my array somewhere in memory, and then I fill that array with stuff. So a number, a string, it really doesn't matter. Now, if I go and null out one of the entries in the array, this little blob of memory here kind of gets left stranded now. It has no connection to anything anymore. Nothing refers to it. In other words, it's not reachable. If we start at a root object, we can't reach that little blob, and thus it's garbage. It's safe to reclaim that memory because nothing can possibly be using it anymore. That's the general idea anyway. Let's see it in action with some code. What I've done here is I've written a really dumb test that just spam fills an object with random strings and other objects. This is called via request animation frame, kind of like you would in a game loop. So see here, I create data, set it to empty to start, then I loop over and create a bunch of junk in there, basically a linked list of objects with random names. And these all have to allocate memory. The strings take up memory, as do the objects themselves. This data variable isn't used anymore at the end of each loop, so we're achieving our goal of wasting memory and forcing the garbage collector to act. So in order to actually test this, you need to be able to measure how much time JavaScript spends in garbage collection. You could pull up DevTools and hit the performance button and dig around there, but there's actually another way that's slightly less known. This is Chrome tracing, the backbone of Chrome's performance testing framework. Hundreds of benchmarks measuring who knows how many thousands of metrics are built on this. In another life, I was an owner here and even led the infra team monitoring and processing all this data. It's pretty cool. You can see and attribute time to various calls, see IPCs between processes. In general, it just gives way, way more info. For our purposes, I think it'll just be easier to focus on what we want to know, garbage collection events. So from here, you can start a trace, choose which events you're interested in. In our case, we only care about V8 stuff, and then start recording. You just need to wait a bit to capture enough of a trace. Just capture however long you want. You don't need to wait to 100%. This uses the Doom keys to move, WASD. So let's zoom in and we can look a bit closely at all these garbage collection events. And we can see that we were successful at provoking the garbage collector into action. All these minor GC calls are V8 in action, reclaiming memory. If we're lucky, maybe we see some major GC calls in here too. These are both versions of V8's garbage collector in action. So that brings up an important question before we move on. What is a minor GC versus a major GC? That's a good question, Simon. Thanks for asking that. V8 has a great blog post that talks in depth about Orinoco, their garbage collector, and goes through some of the high-level details on their collection strategy. There's this idea, the generational hypothesis in garbage collection, that most items die really young, also called infant mortality, because why not just use super morbid terms for memory management? But as a super hand-wavy explanation, V8 basically divides allocations into new and old. You have the new generation and the old generation, and in essence, allocations start in the new generation. So if I allocate a string here, it starts out in the new generation, specifically the nursery section part of this new generation. Then a garbage collection pass happens, and let's assume that some objects are reclaimed and others aren't. If our string happens to survive the first garbage collection attempt, it gets copied out or evacuated into a sort of intermediate area. It's not old yet, but it's not brand new either. Another garbage collection event occurs, a bunch of other stuff gets reclaimed. If, at that point, we find that our object survives, if it's still in use, it gets evacuated out to the old generation. V8 makes this distinction so that it can apply separate strategies for the new and old generations. A minor GC, the scavenger, is optimized to collect from the new generation, while a major GC, which doesn't have a cool name like the mutilator or anything, does the heavy lifting of sifting through the old generation. Maybe you could call it the Reaper or something. So by looking at the trace of our first test, we can actually select the first 10 seconds or so of the trace, and we can see that there were 384 occurrences of minor GC, averaging about 1.079 milliseconds each, and 56 occurrences of major GC at around 0.838 milliseconds each. So our test is getting VA to do some minor and major GCs. So we can change this test around a tiny bit to try and poke the major GC into action. So what I've done here is I just take a random subset of the data and I stuff it into this.stuff, overriding whatever happened to be there. This.stuff is permanent, never deleted for the duration of the test, so this should in theory keep a bunch of random things for a lot longer than a single call of do something stupid, and promote things to the old generation. When we get a trace of the whole thing, and we're just going to select the first 10 seconds or so of the trace, and we can see that this is indeed what happens. We managed to force the garbage collector to work a bit harder, and we've added some time to both minor GC and major GC. To try and understand the relationship between allocation patterns and minor GC and major GC, I fiddled with this a bit more. We'll try creating fewer objects, but make them more complex. This is the trace here. We'll select the first 10 seconds again, and looking at it, minor GC isn't changing a whole lot, but major GC is changing quite substantially, nearly doubling the time taken versus the simpler cases. I poke at this a bit more by adding a setup step to the test, where I just allocate a whole bunch of random crap and store it. It's never referenced in the test, but it's there. When we look at a trace of that, we see our major GC calls getting much more expensive. Although there's fewer calls to major GC, each invocation is taking 26 milliseconds, which for a game would be basically a skip frame, something that would be inexcusable. So that suggests that there's a relationship between the amount of crap you have allocated and how long the GC takes, which, I mean, is hardly surprising. It has to figure out what you're using and not using. It's not magic. If you were using another language where memory management is explicit, such as C++, it wouldn't matter how much or little you have allocated. There's no ongoing cost for having it allocated. You only spend time allocating or freeing. Whereas in JavaScript, there's definitely like a tax on what's currently allocated. I tried a few more experiments to see if I could make minor GCs more expensive. So what I did here was I allocated just some random stuff in a loop. Looking at the trace, we did spend quite a bit of total time in minor GCs. Dwell time is nearly 10% of the time, in fact. Although each singular call to minor GC was just shy of 2 milliseconds, so not quite the crazy long time major GC took. I took another stab at it by allocating sparse arrays and just randomly setting values in there, and V8 kind of laughed that attempt off. Nearly 800 minor GC calls, but they ran in a pretty negligible amount of time. I consider 10% to be pretty bad, but simultaneously it's a ridiculous setup. So maybe instead let's build a somewhat more plausible game setup to see the effects of GC in action. Here's a quick and dirty game setup. So what I've done here is a super basic bare bones game, in quotation marks. I don't bother actually rendering any of this, but we do simulate the entities. So you've got this list of entities, we call update on each one. When they die, we destroy them, then filter them out. And we keep a stable population by creating new ones in their stead. The entities themselves do some legit work, so they have a transform data associated with each one, along with values like energy, health, and they have a spatial hash grid client to track their position in the world and query other entities. They also have this update function, and then I force them to do some random stuff. I didn't feel like making the logic extensive, so I just repeat it a few times. When they're fully charged, they shoot off a bullet, so they create a bullet, and that's added to the world. And bullets are their own thing, they have a full transform, their position is updated according to velocity, and eventually they explode and kill nearby things. So it does some stuff. I took a few traces of this running, chose a bad one, and we can poke around in here a bit. If I select the first 10 seconds or so of the trace, we can see some numbers for minor GC and major GC. We got around 500 or so minor GC calls, taking on average less than half a millisecond, but adding up to around 240 milliseconds or so. There's not many major GC calls, barely any actually, but the ones that do fire take a little over 1.1 milliseconds each. There was always going to be some overhead for garbage collection, but at the same time, this is written super poorly. Realistically, an experienced game developer would code with memory allocations in mind. So let's make this a tiny bit better, but a slightly improved version of these entities that attempts to minimize allocations. In the main loop, we actually reuse entities instead of allocating new ones, and the entities themselves use pre-allocated matrices and vectors to perform their calculations. Nothing super crazy here. Looking at a trace of that version, though, we can see a monster of a difference. Whereas before we had around 500 minor GC calls, this version gets 110 or so, and a touch over 50 milliseconds of total time spent there. There's one major GC call accounting for another millisecond of time. One really interesting thing that stands out here is that in the first example, let's zoom in and look at these minor GC calls. They're happening during the frame, sometimes multiple times, meaning that they're contributing to longer frames. In the second example, they're happening in the idle time between frames, which is totally by design. V8 specifically built this feature into Chrome. When it detects there's an idle period, that's where V8 has the go-ahead to quickly run GC. What I kind of got from all of this was that short-lived objects are often pretty cheap from a GC perspective. That doesn't mean they're free, though. But if you can get them down low enough, they may just run in the idle time between frames, and you may not see much in terms of overhead for it. The more crap you keep in memory, the longer-lived cache stuff, the more expensive your major GCs are, as we saw with my stupid synthetic test. I know my own code, though, usually, so this could probably be at least partially mitigated in the future by just letting me tell you via some sort of API that gives hints to the garbage collector. Something like that. I don't know. I've given this a full 10 seconds of thought. You'd need to actually plan this out more. One major problem with JavaScript, though, is that although for your own app you might be able to control your allocations, with third-party stuff, you have very little control, as far as I know. I mean, in something like C++, it's sort of the same deal, but at least you can override memory allocation at a global level, and depending on your application, extend this to third-party libraries as well. In JavaScript, no such luck. I can't isolate a third-party library to its own memory pool, so that's just something you have to live with. Another thing is that, yeah, of course there's a cost to having GC. Direct management will be more performant when done right. But in reality, decently made games don't just allocate and free on a whim either. Most do it in a very controlled way. I've spent enough time moving systems to different allocation patterns, linear allocators, pool allocators, LIFO and scratchpad style frame allocators in order to wring out extra performance. C++ programmers may love to toot that horn, but even among game devs, that was usually handled by just a few people at the studio, not everyone. In JavaScript, you have some control over memory, but it's pretty tenuous. Mostly it's down to your pattern of allocation, minimizing allocations by reusing objects, that sort of thing. Maybe you could go crazy using typed arrays, but let's save that for another time. And lastly, how much memory overhead does JS incur for doing all of this? How's the performance on Firefox? Etc., etc. Great questions. No idea. Didn't test those. Maybe next time. Throw some comments about what you'd like to see tested in the future. Until next time. Cheers.